in the media conference with Lal Goyal, which is brought to you by V4 News, Global TV, V4 Stream, Malnadu TV India, News Gaon Se, Samvad Sarokar News, Bharat Post News, Organ Donation India Foundation and Gyan. Our endeavor is to enlighten you with the current topic. And today's topic is not only the current, but it's based on the future of the students and those who are going for the higher studies. Then the topic is reopening of higher education institutions. India has a publicly funded higher education system that is the third largest in the world next to the United States and China. The main governing body of the territory level is the University Grant Commission, UGC, which enforces its standards, advises the government, and helps coordinate between the center and the state. Accreditation for higher learning is overseen by 15 autonomous institutions established by the University Grant Commission, UGC. As of 2020, India has over 1,000 universities with a breakup of 54 central universities, 416 state universities, 125 deemed universities, 361 private universities, 7 institutes under State Legislature Act, and 159 institutes of national importance, which includes IIMs, AIIMS, IITs, IIITs, IISERs, and NITs, among others. The pause in the physical classes around the colleges and universities in India caused by the COVID-19 pandemic finally seems to be ending soon. With the decline in COVID-19 cases around the country, several state governments are gearing up for the preparation of reopening the colleges and other educational institutions. This raises a common question in the minds of students: when will colleges reopen in India? Telangana became the first state to lift up the COVID-19 lockdown completely and resume the physical classes in schools and colleges from July 1st onwards. The colleges in Telangana have started special vaccination drives with an aim to vaccinate as many students as they can before reopening the colleges. Himachal Pradesh has reopened all the medical, Ayurvedic, nursing, dental, and pharmacy colleges around the state. States like Karnataka and Madhya Pradesh are planning to reopen the colleges and universities after vaccinating the students and teachers community. The state of Uttarakhand has reopened the colleges and universities for online classes after the summer vacation from June 21st onwards. However, there are still some states like Delhi, Haryana, Meghalaya, and Kerala which are hesitant to reopen the colleges and other educational institutions, fearing the possibility of the third wave. The Bihar government is planning to open up all educational institutions from the month of July in a phased manner. The students could not be contacted by the schools for various online, offline tests, exams, assessments during the complete sessions or during exams, practical timetable, and it was and is not possible to conduct required assessment. Now, because our Honorable Prime Minister, Mr. Modi, has declared that there will be no exams for 12th standard. It means those students who are going to be taking admission in the universities or the colleges are going to get a result based on their 10th, 11th examinations results, as well as the internal assessments of 12th. That is what they have found a formula. But whether the universities and colleges are ready to accept, whether our colleges and university have sufficient seats, because till now, on an average, the Indian average of the passing marks, although those students who pass the exams of 12th, is approximately 70%. But now, because of this new thing that no exams will be conducted, it means 100% students who were supposed to appear in the 12th exam have been cleared and passed and upgraded for the next year. Now, when they are going to take admission in the colleges and university, it's a challenge for the university and the colleges. And the second very, very important point, which is going to be that how to assess, because there are many colleges, institutions in India where there are no internal assessment has taken place, but the guidelines which has come is that in all such cases, it may be ensured that the students are marked absent so that the result is in respect of such student is not declared. It may be noted that the data in respect of these students may not be submitted by awarding them zero mark or mentioning anything else against their names. It means those who have not been able to attend the classes or not been assessed, they will be marked as absent. The school will do an assessment of these subjects of class 11 by using the average of the best three subjects from the subjects actually studied in class 11. The CBSE has opted for a different marking system to finalize the CBSE class 12 board exams 2021 results. Students of CBSE class 12 will be evaluated on the basis of marks obtained in class 10, 11 and class 12 internal and practical exams. But there are many institutions, especially in North India, where no such type of internal exams or practical exams took place due to the COVID and otherwise. And many places because of the elections. So now when this is the situation, how the universities and the colleges who are taking, many of the universities and colleges are taking the cream of the cream of the students. But now it's a very, very big challenge because they want to keep their standard high. And to keep the standard high, they want good students, studious students in their college. So whether they are going to conduct the exams or not, whether they will be taking these marks, whatsoever assessment be done by the CBSE or other boards, that they will take a benchmark wherever the admission, or there will be a general examination again. So these are the very crucial points which colleges and universities are facing. One very more important part is, although the COVID has receded and now the COVID is going down a day by day, but there is a fear of wave three. And if this wave three, which is likely, which experts are saying, no one can say confirmatively, but experts are saying that it is going to strike anytime after 4 weeks or 6 weeks, then what will be the condition of these colleges and the students, whether these colleges will again be shut and again the online education will start. Although many colleges who are autonomous, they have already started their classes, although whether they are in their particular state or not, like I can give an example of Karnataka, many autonomous colleges have started the in-person education, although day before yesterday only, the Chief Minister of Karnataka, Mr. C. Yedurappa, has clearly mentioned that no college, university, schools will be open till the further order. So how they have admitted, have they vaccinated all the students and the teachers or not, or they are above the government of Karnataka, or they are above the government or the ICMR guidelines or WHO guidelines. So that also a very, very crucial point. After all, it's not only the future of students, but it is also the life of students. And the not only students, we have to see the life of teachers and all those employees who are working with these colleges and universities. So now, today, we have a very, very elite, experienced, and those who are authority in this particular field, that is the higher education institutions. And we have the panelists with us. I would like to invite my first panelist, and he is Professor Ramesh Ravikanthol. Professor Ramesh is a qualified entrepreneurship educator and a master trainer in entrepreneurship development. He is certified by National Entrepreneurship Network, Mumbai, Stanford University, USA, IIM, Bangalore, etc. He is also a master trainer in global skill enhancement, certified from Infosys Mysore. He is mentor and advisor to many entrepreneurial training institutes. He has delivered many lectures in arts, science, commerce, management, pharmacy, vocational training, etc. in various colleges. He is an inspirational and motivational speaker. He is recipient of many awards. He was chairman for Youth Festival Committee consistently for 10 years in Lal Bahadur Shastri College, Satara, where he was zoology professor until 2014. He is a pranic healer graduate. He can treat emotional and psychological ailments. He is mentoring the IDBI Rural Self-Employment Training Institute at Satara. Welcome, Professor Ramesh on our show. Professor Ramesh, you were professor till 2014 when you were teaching the zoology. Now that the time has changed, although you are still involved for training the IDBI rural employees, etc. And you have seen how the COVID has impacted, and especially in your state, that is Maharashtra, where so many cases were there, and still Satara is still in the red zone. Now, whether we are fit, we are ready to open our higher educational institutions or not, and what are going to be the impact of this? So for today's topic, that is reopening of higher education institutions, your views, Professor Ramesh Ravikant Ol, please.
A very good morning to you all. I'm a retired professor, Ramesh Ol, from Satara, Maharashtra, India. I was teaching zoology for graduates. Now I'm teaching entrepreneurship to the students at various colleges and women self-help groups. Thanks, Mr. Lal Goyal, sir, for a wonderful introduction. Honorable and respected energetic youth icon, Chairman Organ Donation India Foundation and CAN, Chief Editor, handsome and evergreen, Mr. Lal Goyal, sir, Mr. Paul, the founder of Global TV, good friend of mine, a very humble, great, and down-to-earth human soul, and all the other eminent dignitaries, guest speaker from the educational galaxy, and my delightful audience present here today. Well, sir, a professor is invited to speak today. I will finish my introduction in 45 minutes, and the rest 10 minutes I'll take it to complete the topic. I was joking, sir. Today's topic is on reopening of higher education institutions. Yes, it is very important, and it is great of interest to all the parents and the common man also. Now, the common man, the parents, who are confused and having no idea which door to knock at. Some of them are very happy since the child got promoted to the higher class without giving any exams. But the other parents are hesitant to agitate against the system. Parents whose child being topper and career oriented, waiting for IIT and medical and engineering admissions are in a dilemma. The situation is really pathetic. Even the child who is in a merit list, he's in a merit list holder, will not appreciate to see his report card stating that he is promoted due to COVID-19. A small microscopic organism has made the entire planet Earth at standstill. One can imagine this COVID-19 and its strains having the power and the strength to stop the earthly activities in a fraction of a second. But I think the earth is rejuvenating and taking a fresh breath. We all know after efforts of this the effects of the pandemic on the world's economy, education system, jobs and factories which were closed down, many of them have lost their jobs and many of them have lost their lives too. As we all know that the towns and cities were locked down for the safety of the citizens. I remember a sermon from the Bandra Church father, priest. He said, some of you may have heard about 90/10 secret. 90/10 secret. What is this 90/10 secret or 90/10 secret? 10% of our life is made up of what happens to us, while the 90% of our life is decided by our reactions. Right, it's correct. We have no real control over 10% of the things that happens to us, while the 90% of the things of the life are decided by our immediate, tardy, or late reactions. Yes, we have so many things in our life which we have absolute no control on it. For example, we are in this pandemic. We don't know when this pandemic is going to end. We have no control over the natural calamities like floods, cyclones, rain, maddening traffic, rash driving, petrol, diesel hikes, price hikes, delayed in trains or the transport system, boss getting angry, or even your wife getting angry. No control over it. We have no control over these things. However, there are many other things that we do have control on it. For example, we can choose our attitude in any given situation. We can choose to utilize our lockdown time in creating, innovating something new and useful thing for the betterment of the society. Our attitude can make us or it can break us. In nearby my town, that's known as Karad, two brothers invented a bicycle which runs on the battery. Now it takes only 5 to 10 minutes for charging, and it costs you 5 to 10 rupees only for the charging. And this bike can go for 100 miles non-stop. Now, what they did is they chose this or utilized their time in searching on the YouTube, giving the proper website, going to the proper website, and getting some gadgets or ordering from online to construct the bike. This is a great use of lockdown time. Now, some of them use the time wisely and some otherwise. Our immediate reaction was to close down the offices, schools, colleges, public sectors, and the places where the public are meeting together and they're crowding together. And it is another precautionary measure the lockdown was imposed on the public. I know how much our kiddies are missing their lovely teachers, the schoolmates, the campus, and the new friends, and all the excitement, even the sports and their mischief. College boys and girls are missing their campus, the interaction, the excitement, and the teaching by the eminent professors. I know the theory part can be taught online, but the students belonging to the science stream, it is very difficult for them to teach online because they have practicals to perform. Subjects like chemistry, physics, statistics, biology, they have a practical and they have the dissections to perform. Now, it is not possible for the peer teachers or to professor to show the dissections online to the students. And I don't think so that all the students must be having the smartphone so they can attend the lectures online. I think we are getting scared to react positively on this issue of reopening of the higher educational institution, because 10% decision makers and 90% is the public reactions. The students are missing the quality time, education, and the mentoring from the eminent professors. Our ministry is mulling over reopening colleges with 50% capacity as it's the first step. They will discuss the issue, and they are still discussing the issue with the chief minister and the education minister and the other stakeholders, so that the official announcement can be done. As Mr. Lal Goyal has already said, in the south area, the colleges are reopening and the students are going to the colleges regularly. Now, it is not only the case where the government has to do something or the other people has to. I think the parents should also take initiative and responsibility to train their kids and protect them, how to protect themselves in this pandemic, and not to expect it from the principals and teachers and the vice chancellor for minding and controlling the kids using their masks and their sanitizers. So the government should take the rapid action on vaccination. The children should be vaccinated before they could enter the college campus. They need to control this pandemic. It is very important that they should be educated, and the they have to live a normal life. The children should live a normal life. Now, the union government has also permitted you opening of the schools and higher education institute in phases after depending on the local situation. The schools and colleges across the country are reopening with the several COVID-19 safety guidelines in place, such as the usage of mask and the sanitizer on the institute campus or premises. And strict social distancing has to be mentioned. Now, it is all depending upon the situation and the local conditions of the college, the schools and colleges. UGC has also issued the guidelines for reopening of the colleges and the universities 8 months after the lockdown was imposed. But many of them are still in dilemma whether to be or not to be. Universities across the country have been closed since the mid-March and even before the coronavirus lockdown was imposed. In the UGC, University Grant Commission issued guidelines for their reopening too. They explain how and when the student will go back to the college and the universities. The higher education regulator wants universities and the colleges to call back the research scholars, postgraduate students in the science and technology programs, and the final year undergraduate students for the placement purposes and so other cases. However, the number of students attending the classes on the campus at a given time should not be more than the half the total student strength of the guidelines. Now, this is going to be difficult because some of them will be benefited and some of them will be like, they'll feel that they are rejected. As we said, like only the scholars and the toppers are admitted in the college, the others will not be permitted. So it is going to be injustice on the students also. The remaining students will encourage to continue online learning. I don't know how many of them really, they have the smartphone where they can really attend the lectures from the eminent professor, but they may visit their departments in a smaller group with a prior appointment to consult the faculty member. This is, I think it's a good news for them. The institution should have a plan ready for such international students also who could join the program due to the international travel restrictions, their visa related issues. Online teaching and learning arrangement should also be made for them, the guidelines from the state government and the Maharashtra government has to be work on that and impose the further schedule for it. Besides, from the standard precautions such as the regulation, disinfection, institution premises, the temperature screening of teachers and students on the campus, higher education institutes will end up in remaining open for a longer hours for 6 days or a week and accommodate students in batches and ensure the social distancing. There are so many things where the government and the, even in the parents and the local people and we all are supposed to take care of. Wearing a mask is mandatory for all the teachers and staff on the campus. The class will be broken up into the multiple sections with each section attending in-person lessons on rotation basis. The visitors should either not be allowed at all or the entry should be drastically restricted. The guidelines has to be stated and given by the colleges or the universities, which will be strictly followed. The cultural activities and meeting will be avoided. However, the extracurricular sports and activities may be allowed, but only the physical standing is possible. Otherwise, this mixing of the people will again create the chaos in the society. With all this, I strongly feel that rather than getting scared with the reactions of the public, the proper decision should be taken on reopening of the educational institute with the proper planning so that the new talent will not get wasted. They are the future of our bright India. Let the children get their right to education in proper way. So I think this is, in short, I have spoken about today's need for reopening of the institutions and the higher institution. Thank you for the opportunity given. Take care. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you very much, Professor Ramesh, all for giving your views. And Professor Ramesh is all for reopening of higher education. Although he has made few reservation, he says that those students who are merit in the merit list, always those stood in the top list. And they are having a problem because they feel that their result will show as a pass. And once it is passed, means they will not get any rank, proper rank. And once they are not getting rank, their future will not be as they were expecting, because they were supposed to get that admission in the top colleges or prestigious universities in India or abroad. But once the result will be showing the pass due to the COVID impact or pandemic, so they will not get the university or colleges of their choice. That is their reservation, number one. Number two, he says that those students who are not studious or who are expecting that they will not be able to pass 12th, they will be promoted. So they are happy. So there are both the reactions. So those who are studious, they are very unhappy. But those who are not, they are very happy. But he mentioned one thing, that there is no control on the pandemic. So neither the individual nor the government any control. But he suggested that because now UGC has given a detailed guidelines at the time of reopening of higher education, what the institute has to follow and what the students and the teachers has to follow, which he has described. But he says one very important thing is that the parents should play a very important role to guide their children how to behave in this pandemic time. And he says that in the interest of the future of the students and the future of the nation, the reopening of higher education is required. Thank you very much, Professor Ramesh, for giving your views. I will come in the next round when I will ask the question on this only. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Like to invite my next guest, and he is Professor Dr. Janeshwar Pai Marur. Professor Pai is MBA, MPhil, PhD. He is a professor at Justice K.S. Hegde Institute of Management, NITTE. He has qualified KSAT management examinations conducted by University of Mysore in 2013. He has over 18 years of industry teaching and research experience. He has worked as lecturer at SDM College of Business Management and Postgraduate Centers for Management Studies and Research, Mangaluru, from 2003 to 2006. He has worked with JP Morgan Chase Bank in India and New York, Delaware, USA corporate office from 2006 to 2012. His teaching and research areas include behavioral and corporate finance, enterprise risk management, and corporate trade taxation, and has a strong exposure in practical knowledge of various statistical packages such as SPSS, MAT Lab, etc. He has published research papers in national and international journals and also presented research papers in various national and international conferences, seminars, and workshops. He is a life member of Indian Institute of Banking and Finance, IIBF, Mumbai Management Teachers Consortium, Global MTC, Global Bangalore, International Association of Academicians and Researchers, INAAR Pune, Indian Academicians and Researchers Association, IARA Assam, and Federation of Indian Professional Trainers, FIPT, New Delhi. Welcome, Professor Dr. Pai, on our show. Professor Dr. Pai, you have heard what Professor Ramesh has mentioned, and he is for reopening of higher education institutions, although he is having the reservation about the merits of those students who are supposed to get top 10 places or 10-30 places, but now it will be all in one way. According to him, few are happy, few are not. But now, because you are right now working in a higher education institution, and you know that even if it is going to open, there are lots of challenges. So we would like to know those challenges. How? Because after all, it's easy to say that please reopen the education institutions. But what type of challenges the institutions are going to face or they are facing? And what, according to you, should be the solution? So reopening of higher education institutions, Professor Dr. Janeshwar Pai Marur, please.
Very good morning, Lal Goyal sir, elite panelists, Professor Ramesh Ravikant, my senior learned friends, Dr. Catherine Nirmala and Dr. Nagendra S., and dear viewers. It's indeed my privilege to share my views on today's, I would say, hot topic for discussion, reopening of higher education institutions. As we all know that India's lockdown, or so-called Janta Curfew in 2020, caused a major upheaval to our teaching, learning, and research. Higher education institutions reopened somewhere in Jan 2021 with a great hope as nationwide vaccination was launched. But this openness lasted only for a few months. As an academician, I thought that we were regaining the old, good old momentum, the Achhe Bite Din, in our academic work and in our plans to expand and grow in teaching and research. But all of a sudden, we are back on our knees. Goyal sir, let me tell you, there has been a widespread disappointment amongst the academic community or the fraternity that neither the government, both at center as well as the state, nor the public heeded to the scientific advice to wear masks, maintain social distance, and avoid mass gatherings for election rallies and spiritual melas and events. Talking about the higher education institutions, clearly there is no perfect time to reopen that can be uniformly applied to all education institutions. I feel that it is high time this is fully decentralized. The decision to open up higher education institution campuses under its ambit must be taken by the local administration or the concerned university setup after discussing with the college administration. This reality of reopening higher education institution during the fag end of the second wave, we have not seen the new mutants yet. We have not witnessed the many more waves, poses loads of daunting challenges that must be surmounted and question must be answered even before we really think of reopening the gates of our institutions and universities in this new post-COVID reality. The big question is, how will the students come to college? That is something which has to be answered first. Can we ensure the buses are safe and do not become infection hotspots? After all, our students have received only their first jab of vaccination and immunity is yet to build. Is it better to ask students to come on their own? But that's going to be very risky, with the youth riding or driving. Or can we ask parents to reach their wards to the institutions instead? But that's going to be very expensive deal if institutions are located way far off or outside the city limits. That's about commuting to the college. Let us talk about the institution level. At institutional level, how do we find indoor spaces large, sufficiently large enough to accommodate the whole class while maintaining social distancing? None of our classrooms have been planned to maintain social distancing. Let us accept that. More importantly, what are the protocols to follow to ensure that we are not putting our students or children at risk when they step out of the classroom? Let us talk about the corridors of our college. Are the corridors broad enough for the students to pass each other? Do we have safe restrooms and water coolers? What is the risk in running a cafeteria or canteen with the sharing of crockery and cutlery? Will we be able to ask students to submit their handwritten workbook or assignments or projects? See, there are no easy answers. There will be no one size fits all type of solution either. This will require close coordination and cooperation among students, staff, and the parents. I feel that this will also require deep understanding of interlinked and causal issues from the perspective of all the stakeholders, be it students, parents, industry, you name it. But with the decision now coming, becoming very crucial and critical, it is worthwhile to understand the risks to bear in mind as we reopen our lush green physical campuses of higher education institutions. I have listed down the various points. Number one, the risks of COVID cases. One of the overriding concerns with the reopening of higher education institution is contagion itself. Let us understand this. As campuses open up, students are more likely to resume their obvious natural social interactions and may grow careless in adhering to COVID precautions and protocols. This raises the risk of outbreaks in campus and is very important to mitigate, as multiple cases may result in building becoming being sealed, which may cause learning disruptions again and additional anxiety among students, which is unsought for. Point number two is increased cost. The most critical condition posed by the government for opening up of higher education institution is ensuring safe practices within the premises or the campuses. All institutions are required to follow the standard operating procedures, such as provision of hand sanitizers, arranging of social distancing, disinfection of the common or the public areas. See, consequently, institutions will need to invest on protective equipment, such as PPE kits, masks, COVID compliant cleaning supplies, and in installing high powered filters on ventilation systems. See, all these things will add up to the substantial cost for the institution, which subsequently will be realized from in the form of collection of the higher fees. Point number three is the mental health risk. Let me try to point something sarcastically. See, there is a good blend of health scares due to COVID pandemic and the proctored lockdown. These have created a widespread impact on the mental well-being of people across the world, particularly amongst the youth students. A US study of university students found that 71% reported increased stress and anxiety during the lockdown period. This was in the early 2021. While the opening up of higher education institutions may provide some sort of relief from issues caused by prolonged physical distancing and lack of social interactions, the increased exposure also intensifies the risk of contacting this particular deadly virus that too very, very easily. Anxiety over one's health as well as that of one's family may witness a spike, with students now leaving their home to attend physical classes. Point number four is reduced attention span of students in the classroom. With the lockdown having lasted for more than a year now, many students have become used to the new normal as far as online learning is concerned. Students now returning to campus may find themselves constrained as they have to readjust to the classroom teaching and learning, which did not happen for the past more than a year. Let us all understand, we as academicians, let us all understand, during this year, the learning level of our students will dip. Perhaps we just have to embrace it. That's it. Point number five is reduced productivity. However alien a given situation may seem at first, the human nature, our human nature allows us to adapt to it eventually. That's called as the law of nature. While many teachers, including me, I'm also a teacher, initially found online teaching to be very challenging and tough, by now, most of us have adapted to the new methods. There were several advantages of conducting online classes from the comfort of home. I personally liked the conducting online classes because I was avoiding traffic, saving time on my commute. I gained a lot. As institutions open up, a return to the previous routine is bound to create some sort of discomfort. So students also will suffer. Faculties will also suffer for first few days, which may impact the productivity of few faculty members as the higher education institutions open up. Point number six is the reduced enrollments. While institutions are now ready to reopen, the fear of COVID-19, let us understand, is still widely prevalent. Colleges in US have already seen the impact of pandemic with the sharp drop in the college enrollments. I fear the same pattern may be repeated in India as students stay away for safety concerns. Students who might have earlier opted for higher education in a city away from home may now opt to enroll in an institution or a college that requires them to live, that does not require them to live elsewhere. The seventh and the last point, which I feel is very crucial, is the lower attendance. Many institutions are following a staggered schedule for students where 50% of the batch is in attendance and the rest of them log in online. With many students reluctant to attend physical classes, attendance is likely to be even lower. Many outstation students had gone back to their hometowns prior to the lockdown. I feel that they may not come back. They may not want to come back despite partial erasing of restrictions from the government. They wouldn't like to come back again, and they would prefer to continue with their online classes. Now, let me tell you that there are easy solutions for reopening. Number one is strict compliance with the COVID safety norms, including sanitization of common areas and wearing masks by the students, staffs, and faculty all the times. Establishing frequent and transparent communication channels just to avoid a panicky situation. All safety-related protocols must be communicated daily and frequently through notices, announcements, and various other forms. Physical distancing should be imposed through various means, such as inviting students in batches, which I call as staggered, so that classes are never full. Staggered lunch times or lunch breaks can prevent crowding, canteens getting overcrowded. The next point is ensure proper circulation of air in indoor spaces through open windows or high-powered filters on ventilation systems. We need to emphasize the importance of staying home when sick, even if it is during examination. Ensure adequate availability of doctors on duty in campus, including the most important thing is mental health counselors, which is very important now. A contingency plan must be kept ready in the event that an infection is reported in the campus. We never know. It is very unsought for. The next one is constitute a COVID task force that will handle all related matters, including the communication. So to conclude, I would say online learning, which was considered a panacea in the time of COVID-19 crisis, has caused enough disruption in our higher education system. I personally feel that the doors of higher education institutions must be open as soon as possible for the knowledge seekers, considering the future of our students, strictly following COVID protocols. This deadly virus is going to be here for some more time or some more years or some more decades, which we do not know. As lockdown comes to an end and a reopening of higher education institutions in a staggered manner, every education institution is trying to see which remote learning technology might work best, from mobile-based apps to television. Blended learning, where both online and offline formats combine seamlessly for effective delivery, will most likely to be preferred mode of teaching in the future. However, this will necessarily favor high-income children, and despite an intention to build inclusion into the policies, remote and rural children will undeniably miss out. India faces a huge digital divide, which Lal Goyal sir has been pointing on various sessions. With nearly 4% of rural households having access to computers and less than 14% having access to internet, government, NGOs, and other public-private organizations should try to elevate the digital divide through appropriate technology partnership as we now open up the gates of our higher education institutions. Thank you, Lal Goyal sir. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you very much, Professor Dr. Pai, for giving your views. And according to Professor Dr. Pai, this pandemic, he is quite unhappy because he says that whether it's a leadership or the public or the students or whosoever, they all are responsible for this, at least the second wave, because we have not followed the social distancing norms, wearing masks, etc. He also mentioned that now when the government has decided and when the universities are opening their gates and the colleges are opening the gates, the problem comes how the students who are coming in the buses or transports, they are using different transports, how they can be saved from this type of infection. He also mentioned about that there are no college which is having any proper arrangement of the social distancing, whether in the classrooms or the corridors or the canteen, library, etc., etc. So he says all those things are to be decided and to be taken consideration before reopening the colleges, or there are certain things which he has suggested afterwards. But first thing he mentioned very clearly that the risk of reopening will be so many. And he has given all the thing. First, the foremost is the increased cost for the college, because any college which has to keep the social distancing means if the 50 or 70 students in one class, they have to make it 50%. Then they have to reduce, they have to increase the timings. Definitely, it is a burden, extra burden. They have to provide sanitizers. They have to provide the mask. So according to them, when this cost will be extra, who is going to bear the cost? If the government is not bearing, then definitely it will pass off to the students, whether they are ready for this or not. Then he mentioned about the mental health. The students faced a very, very big dilemma, because once online, then again in person. So they are in fix. And he even says that the students who are going to come to the classes, they will have lots of problems to adjust themselves for the offline or in-person classes, because they have adjusted themselves for the online classes. And same thing he said about the faculty. It's very, very difficult, because earlier they were not knowing means they were not having that much exposure for the online education. But now when they are accustomed to that, they again come back to the offline or the in-person is again a very, very big challenge to them. And according to Professor Dr. Pai, the productivity from the point of the faculty as well, the students, everything will go down. Secondly, admissions will be less. And he has given the examples of USA. He says that this year, the admissions in those universities, leading universities, are quite less. So this is going to happen here. And if the admissions will be less, then the viability of a private college, those who are not government aided, will have lots of problems. Then attendance will be, there will be less attendance, because the students who are, even those who are joined because of the lockdown or because of the any other situation, they will be not regularly attending the classes, which will again a problem. So all these things, and he says the blending learning, one solution is, but that solution is not practical because it's very expensive. And how many students can afford to have the laptops or mobiles there, as well as the proper internet connections? And it will be as digital divide is already there in India. So what is going to happen to those students who are staying in the rural area? Thank you very much, Professor Pai, for giving your views. Now I would like to invite my next guest, and she is Dr. Catherine Nirmala. Dr. Catherine Nirmala is MCOM, MBA, CS, MPhil, PhD. She is the Associate Professor and Recognized Research Guide at Postgraduate Department of Commerce, St. Agnes Center for Postgraduate Studies and Research, Mangaluru. She is the Guest Faculty for CPT in the Institute of Chartered Accountancy and St. Aloysius PU College, Mangaluru. She is the former principal of Kolaco College of Management, Mangaluru. She was the professor in business management at St. Agnes College for 17 years. She is the recruiter for Max Life Insurance. She completed 2 research projects and presented 23 papers in national and 12 papers in international conferences. She is keenly interested in women's empowerment, student welfare, and counseling. Welcome, Dr. Catherine Nirmala, on our show. Dr. Catherine Nirmala, you have heard what Professor Ramesh as well as Professor Dr. Pai has mentioned. Now, we would like to know your views on reopening of higher education institutions. Dr. Catherine Nirmala, please.
It is indeed an honor and privilege for me to share screen with this esteemed panel and share my views on the challenges of reopening of higher educations in India. I feel that we are coming back to back and forth discussing the same issue, which is so relevant because we have still not found a solution. And the question here is there a solution? You know, we are here to discuss these things as to what is the best possible way in which to address this issue so as to ensure the minimum loss. So with this framework, I would like to say that as a commerce professor, I would like to examine the cost of lockdown, the cost of lockdown of higher educations. What in terms of cost, what has happened over the last 3 months, the second wave, and last year for 4 months during the first wave. So if we were to look at the cost and analyze where we have lost, I would like to take one reference to a study conducted in England with the previous pandemic that happened way back in the 1970s. And when they measured what was the loss, an 8-week lockdown had hampered the academic quality of the students by 40%, that 8 week of lockdown. And if we were to proportionally calculate the cost of the number of months that we have faced on wave one and wave two, lockdown one and lockdown two, on educational institutions, I am bereft of words to think of the damage that it has caused to our students. So when we are thinking and discussing about going forward with reopening, let us look at the hampering that has happened to the educational activity and then say whether we can afford to have this lockdown, whether we can continue. If we are able to just analyze the extent of damage caused to our educational activity and the academic chaos that has resulted in this back-to-back, two continuous consecutive years of disruption, then probably we need to address this as an academic emergency. And probably the whole address of this issue will be addressed in a totally different manner. So first of all, the educational activity, the amount that has been hampered, the amount. Now, the academic calendars of different universities, different states, we are talking about higher education. So higher education essentially means degree onwards. Now, degree cannot be taken exclusively. We have to go by whether the plus two students, the PUC students have finished their exams. The exams for the pre-university students in Karnataka was cancelled, whereas the exams for SSLC was not cancelled. They are going ahead and younger children are made to answer the exam. And 12 standard children, the CBSE cancelled exams for the whole, straight on blanket ban on all exams. So there is no uniformity, and I'm trying to bring, make light in this panel about the extent of chaos that has happened, which has made it so difficult for us to even take a step forward. And all we need to do is think of how we can amend things now, how we can set things right now. So the different boards have taken different stands. Some have made 100% pass, some have made the students answering the exams. So the entire academic year has faced different rules and regulations because of the autonomous colleges or the governments which have taken different stands. So there is a huge gap in the way in which states have handled the pandemic and the different levels at which this pandemic has been handled, especially from the point of view of academics. Now, the impact that it has had on employment, our students who have passed out last year have not been employed. I think there has not even been 20% employment rate. I would say, I don't know, my colleagues may agree with me or disagree with me. the employability of our students have been hampered, and the level at the number of students who have been employed have also come to a standstill. So that concern is the employment rate. The unemployment rate is very high, and we need to put things back on gear, because fresh graduates are sometimes employed, and because the colleges have not conducted the exams, they have not been able to report for work. So that is another very serious issue, because the exams have not been conducted, and the student with difficulty has got a placement, because I know that one of my students lost her job in Dubai only because she was not able to report for work in the month of May. So the cost of this to the students is enormous. This is another cost of students losing employment, because their academic year, which was supposed to get over by May, is now still dragging on, and we are in the month of July. Now, thirdly, the maturity of the students in terms of attending online classes. For how much more time can we continue online classes? Has there been an increase in the maturity level of the students? Do we have more student engagement today than what we had last year? Are our students interacting in the class? Are our students paying attention to what we are saying? I am facing a real difficulty in going forward, as Professor Ramesh said, in practical papers. I can sense that my students are not able to keep up with me, because I know that they must be distracted with various other things. For all I know, they may be having their breakfast or cooking, or in terms of maturity, our students have not improved. In spite of 1 year of online classes here and there, back to forth, our students are not able to give 100% attention to the online classes, and we are able to make this out, and we are unable to proceed with our portions the way we do it in offline classes. We are unable to get 100% attention from the student, and when it is a theory paper, we just rattle off and the students don't care, because at the end of the day, they just study on their own and they answer the exams. But when it comes to practical papers, the onus is on the student to understand, to pay attention. And very conveniently, the students will switch off and sit in front of the, hidden behind the video. And I'm sorry to say that postgraduate students have not exhibited much maturity in the past 1 year. And I have seen the same kind of attitude and behavior. So I would say that online classes are a sham to that extent. So we are not really adding value as teachers. So the employment, as I said, the employment opportunity within India, and of course, students who want to pursue their courses outside India, all these things are all hampered to such an extent. So as my esteemed colleague, Dr. Nyaneshwar Pai, already mentioned, the enrollment list is scary. How many institutions can withstand this second year of enrollment issues? Our students are hesitating because they don't know what is going to happen. They don't want to pay the fees. The management is not willing to reduce the fees. And the high fees are not worth it. We all know that a student should not pay so much for an online course, because the student is not really able to get the grooming that is given in an offline, in a full offline course, or in the true sense of academic goals. A student has to get groomed overall. It is not only to get a degree that a student is coming to college. So on the personal personality front, on the academic front, on the intellectual front, on the spiritual quotient front, in the personality whole has to be developed in higher education and undergraduate education. So this being the situation, we are not able to motivate the students and say, come on, register for the course, because heart of hearts, we know that we are not doing justice to the student. And if you are measuring the cost benefit analysis from the student perspective also, the student has not much to gain on this online platform. So along with my colleagues, I also would recommend that there be a phased unlock, and this phased unlock has to start immediately, just like for other, you know, for the other facilities, you know, for essential commodities, we started, the government started with phased unlock. And today we have our shops open till 9 o'clock. I think phased unlock should start immediately. And I agree with my colleagues when they say that no college has the facility of providing social distancing for all students at the same time, but we have to make some provision where the first years come on first on Monday, Wednesday, Fridays, and the second years come on on alternate days, and students have to have that connect once again. The disruption has been too much. And another thing is, there is a lot of discrepancy in the way universities in Karnataka, since I'm from Karnataka, have handled it. Now, some universities have made it mandatory. The state universities like Mangalore University or the many Bangalore universities, now all of them have taken a different stand. So also the technical institute like university like VTU has taken a different stand. The Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Sciences has taken a different stand. And among the colleges that are under these universities, again, there is a total chaos here as to who wants to do what. The opinions are different. But at the end of the day, I think we have to get us to the gates of our higher education open, so that when the higher education institutions are open and universities start functioning, then we can slowly start with the lower classes. And so at least by the coming academic year, we can have a disruption-free, academic chaos-free year. Now, I agree with all of you saying that the challenges in terms of ensuring the safety of the students, as to how they can avoid, you know, the sickness and how, you know, and I will not repeat, but I simply reiterate whatever my colleagues have spoken in terms of ensuring safety of the students on the campus. I agree with them 100%. I agree with them. But the question still is whether we can make it mandatory for the students to come on campus. That I think is not possible. Because some of our students come from far, some of our students have to stay in the hostel, so hostels are not open. So I agree that with the necessity for blended learning to whatever extent possible. So I would suggest that in addition to the regular classes that are going on, with even though it may be a regular chalk talk method or use of LCDs, but the student who is not able to attend the classes in person has to be given the alternative. Attendance should not be made mandatory. They should be able to have access online in the form of recorded videos. And in that case, the onus will be on the student. The student knows that rest of her classmates or his classmates are in college, and so she or he has to take the responsibility of learning it. So my point is, you cannot make it mandatory, though I say unlock and unlock immediately, but I would say that you can't make it mandatory, because every student is an individual with different needs, even in terms of the immunities conditions or the health conditions of individual students. We cannot put them on the same parameters. So we cannot in any way consider that students are all the same nature or caliber. So we have to ensure that practicals are conducted in college immediately for medical students, dental students, for engineering students. The students have to be brought on par with what they would have been otherwise. And we see a lot of jokes going around in social media saying that this particular batch is the corona batch, and therefore, within quotes, the unemployable batch. Now, we as academicians, we have to ensure that this horrible thing does not happen. Our students have suffered enough. So whatever is possible from our side, we have to minimize the damage. And for how long can we sit inside? For how long can we, you know, only employ the defensive strategy? We have to teach our students to be offensive. We have to take the offensive stand and say, now you have to protect yourself in this challenging situation. This 3+ months in the second wave is enough of damage, and our students have to be out of this academic year and get ready to face the challenges that they are already going to encounter in the corporate world due to loss of jobs and things like that. So my personal suggestion is measure the cost and benefit and take a step forward and ensure minimum damage and move forward with phased unlock and get our students back on campus. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Catherine, for giving the details. And her view is very clear that reopening can be done, but it should be in a phased manner or the staggered manner so that the cost analysis can be done for the students as well as for the institutions. One point I would like to highlight because of the paucity of the time. She says it's the academic emergency, which is a very, very important point she has raised, because if the academicians are feeling that now it's a condition, emergency condition, I'm sure the government of the day should take some action immediately so that there should not be a crisis, very big crisis, which is looming ahead of the education sector. Thank you very much, Dr. Catherine. Now, I would like to invite my next guest, and he's Dr. Nagendra Ress. Dr. Nagendra Ress has done his post-graduation in economics from Mangalore University in 2004. He has done his MBA in marketing from KSOU, Mysore. He obtained his doctoral degree in economics from Mangalore University in 2008. His experience in teaching, including managerial economics, business statistics, econometrics, financial management, strategic credit management, banking and financial services, insurance and risk management, merger and acquisition and marketing subjects. He has published 4 books with sole and co-authorship, 1 edited book, 4 scopes plus publication and UGC care list publications along with peer reviewed publications. He is having total 19 national and international publications to his credit. He has reviewed manuscripts for international journals. At present, he is the chief advisor of 3 international journals. He has attended total 14 conferences and presented papers and organized 15 guest talks training programs. At present, he is faculty at SDM College Ujre in retail and supply chain management. Welcome, Dr. Nagendra Ress, on our show. You have heard our earlier panelists, Professor Ramesh, Professor Dr. Pai, Professor Dr. Catherine. Now we would like to know your views on the reopening of higher education institutions. Dr. Nagendra Ress, please.
Many thanks, Mr. Lal Goyal, sir, chairman of Organ Donation India Foundation and GAMP, for giving me an opportunity to share my few views on the reopening of higher education institutions. So first, I would like to thank my fellow panelists and speakers for sharing their valuable views on this. Let me take you through some of the bads and goods of this COVID and reopening also. First, I would like to take you through the bats. That is, when we face this problem, that is COVID, and we moved to online education, the big challenge the students and even the faculty members faced is the poor internet connections, because in the most of the rural areas we don't have proper internet connection, so that disrupted the learning. So that is the one important thing we have to note, because everybody could not access it properly, though we had recorded videos and we have sent that, but they couldn't interact with the faculty because of the poor internet connection. So another important problem we encountered during the time of COVID when we were doing the online education is the health complication, possible health complications, because for any online learning, there will be ideal or the online learning timings. Like if you take international level, there will be online learning is 2 hours. And in India, I think it is 3 hours. I think, government already made it like up to 12th standard, it's not more than 3 hours or 2 hours like that they made it. It's a good one. But, when it comes to the higher education, PG courses, it was not that much clear. And some of the organizations were able to, implement it, the ideal hours, learning hours, but not all the organizations or institutions. So because of this, there is a high possibility of, going through some of the whatever that mental stress or maybe you know ear problem, an eye problem like that, they may might have encountered. This is we cannot simply ignore it, though it is some places it maybe might not report some of us may be encountered, but we cannot ignore it because it's in health is very important. So that's the one point. Another point is, you know, the best thing, you know, what is going to happen is, you know, we are coming out from that, because if you are going to open it very systematically, and if you are open it, you know, very systematically as per the government rules, and if you are able to handle it properly, then these problems are, they are not going to encounter, like, you know, health related issues and the internet connectivity problem, they are not going to encounter. So that is the, you know, what that good news. So if it is, you know, happens as per our what that the plan, then another thing is, you know, the challenge of online education. So this challenge is, you know, going to be faced by the educational institutions, because now what happened during the COVID time, the students, they are accustomed to these things, as in our earlier, you know, panelists rightly told. And then recently, under new education rule, it had, you know, we came to know that the online education that is, you know, advised by the Ministry of Education, that, you know, that can be implemented more than 60%, I think more than 40%. Courses can be taught online. Okay, there's one thing. Then another thing is some of the universities got, you know, permission to run online education. Okay, and then the students also, you know, accustomed to this one, and they also started searching. There is a possibility of, when it comes online, there is also possibility of, you know, lots of online education companies, maybe intermediaries or maybe the universities abroad. Those who are, you know, operating abroad, they might have already, by using their data analytics, they might have shooted this and add to this students. So they came to know that online education is becoming prominent now, and it's equally valid. And, you know, with less, not less effort, rather I can say with more convenient time, they can get, you know, foreign degrees, maybe PhD also possible, and post graduation also possible, micro master course also possible, and equally valid. And even 1 year course are available out there, instead of going for 2 years courses. So this is giving a serious challenge to the Indian education system to upgrade themselves, because now it is open. Everybody is coming to know the things. It's nothing is going to conceal. And students are slowly exposed to this, you know, data analytics. Because of that, you know, they are going to get direct over that advertisement shoots from the companies. So this is going to put a challenge to the existing system in India. They have to think about this one now, because they simply, you know, cannot think of, you know, how they were, you know, earlier thinking. Now they are thinking of that one. That's why they made recent what the changes in the education system. They told that 40% you can give online, and also they have given what the permission to some of the universities that you can run, like, you know, Jain University there in Bangalore, and then many other universities, they started their online education courses, and it is equally, you know, valid. So what about that one? So whenever we're talking about what that online is, you know, very big problem, but in a side by way, online education is, you know, excelling, and then, you know, people are getting online education, and they are, you know, that education is equally valid as per the UEC, World Economic, or that education council, whatever. Yeah, they're saying that, you know, instead of having 2 years degree, I'm going to have 1 year degree, PG degree, which is equally valid all throughout the globe. So then you have to think about the education issues in India, have to think about that one, because, you know, this change is going to happen, whether we are ready for that one, whether we are able to compete with those things, that they have to think very seriously. That's one point. So another thing is, you know, when I attended one World Economic Forum last week, 23rd June 2021, then they had the agenda that is, you know, strengthening global equity and travel. They were, you know, talking about international logistic and international supply chain management. Then they, you know, they were, you know, talking about even India, because even Indian delegates were there, like more than 100 countries delegates were there, participants were there, and delegates from many countries were there. Indian Economic Forum, World Economic Forum, I participated in that. Then, you know, the host just, you know, put a word, and he told that, you know, India is in the tunnel. Because during the COVID situation, it's in the tunnel. Tunnel means, you know, that there is no light. It is a darkness. It will be there, and we are not going to see any light in the end. So yes, you know, I understand this, you know, statement, because we are not going to see the what a light in the end means, you know. So if some light is there, okay, we can have some hope. That means, you know, they are, you know, talking about there are some disruptions in the economic activities because of the COVID, and the vaccination rate maybe, or maybe normalcy index they may be worried about. We have to think about that one. What is that? So because, you know, education, why I'm linking this, because education institutions are the, you know, main hub, because, you know, where you can see the mob, students are coming in a big number. And if you just take an example of how it is going to spread very speedily, it is spreading very speedily through the mob. You know that once it is going to outbreak, it will easily spread very speedily because mobs are there. In education institutions, mobs are there, and then in the malls, mobs are there, and in cinema theaters, mobs are there, and in the market, mobs are there. So mobs means it's a gathering. So in education institutions, gatherings are there. So if anything goes wrong, it's a big threat. You know, it's a big problem. So we have to take it very seriously. So how we can do that? Reopening is going to happen, but how we can do that? The point is here, now, are they having really awareness? Students are having awareness. If you take an example of small kids, they are not having awareness because they are small kids. So a lot of control is required. But in this case, young generation, those who are there in the education institutions, higher education institutions, they are having the tendency to act very normally. Like, as our other panelists tried to point out, because that in age is like that. Because in 2 days, they'll forget and they'll come back to normalcy. So if you're coming back to the normalcy in our behavior, we are going to face the abnormalcy. So we never come back to normalcy. So what we have to do is, we have to act abnormally. But whether it is, properly, inculcated. So how we can do that? Now the situation is these students, they have in their mind, what is that, See, it is in a health problem. And my friends, classmates, some of them, encountered this one. They got infected. But in 1 week, within a couple of days, they were able to overcome that one. So I'm angry. I can also overcome that one. Like that, some mentality, some. I'm not saying everybody is having, If one person is having that mentality also, it is going to infect over that affect very badly. Because one person if get infected, and if he's going other places, if he's not going to get serious health problem also, till he is going to be one of that grid area kind of thing. Like if he or she is going to infect it to many, what happens? Here another picture I'm going to take you through. That is it is not about the health implications. So health implications will be there definitely. Other implications, like whenever it is going to happen, it is going to spread. The data government is going to get through its national informatics or other system because the database will be there. So once they get the data, what happens? They'll come to know that okay, it is increasing. It's not coming down. Now when during the lockdown, it is decreasing. When lockdown is over, again it is increasing. Let us do the lockdown again. So what is the consequence next? The next consequence is economic disruption. So the consequence of economic disruption will be very serious other problems like psychological problems, emotional problems because of job loss, and psychological problems because of the less business. That your parents are going to encounter that one. You have to understand those problems, my dear students. It is not only the health implications, it is also other implications. Because of this, you are going to face other implications. Your parents are going to be suffered in their business, and they are psychologically, they may be down. Their standard of living will come down, and the job they may lose. Who is going to affect? So that maturity you have to get now. That maturity you have to get. Then only you will act. I have seen, I'm not simply blaming. Somewhere I have seen, I don't want to name which college like that, but in a general observation, once they come back, to the, lockdown is over, they'll start taking selfies very friendly.
Dr. Nagendra, I think the time is short. So yeah, if you can conclude. Yes,
I'll wind up. So I'm saying that, the government is taking all that measures and the colleges are also taking measures. At the same time, I'm saying that, my dear student friends, you have to, think very typically, not only health point of view, but other point of view. Because, if you, put these efforts, so you can really, you can contribute to, counteract this one. And about the vaccination, I would say, I'm working in SGM College, I have to thank them because, all our staff got vaccinated. I got vaccinated last week. And then, all the students, nearby students, those are staying nearby that, radius, so they got vaccinated. And also they, sent a circular that, it's not compulsion, like, in your native place, you get the vaccination and soon you are going to start the colleges within a couple of weeks like that, after the government orders like that.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nagin, for giving your views. Thank you. Now my question goes to Professor Ramesh. Very short answer from you. Why not declare a zero year when these are the problems and when we are not sure whether tomorrow again this wave 3 will come and when the standard of the students have gone down, as our one of the panelists says that there are a pandemic student, COVID students, and employability is not there. Why to reopen the colleges, only declare a zero year once the situation is normal, then only teach? Or what you say about this, Professor Ramesh? Short answer, please.
Sir, it is all difficult what you're saying to declare it as a zero year. as the madam also said, it is an academic emergency. Taking of this kind of decision is very difficult because children will be losing 1 year or 2 years or whatever it may be. And what they are going to gain out of it? Because they are losing the knowledge, they are not getting. And again, it is a problem like it is a COVID-19 unemployability will be there. People will be stamped like that. And
But Professor Ramesh, I will just tell you, this thing has happened in past when there was Mandal Commission in North India. The agitation was on, or against the English, there was, or against Hindi. So many times it has happened that almost 1 year is been put on the abeyance, and then they will take, they have taken the exams. So it is not that it's a new thing, because the thing is the standard of education has to be maintained. Otherwise, they will not get the employability. That is my root thing. Yes, please. You want to say something, Professor Mish? No, I think we have lost. Anyway, now my question goes to Professor Dr. Pai. Dr. Pai, you are mentioning about the vaccination. In India, we are having a double standard. Those students who are getting admission in USA universities, they are entitled, allowed to have the second dose within 4 weeks, after the completion of 4 weeks. While in India, for a student, it is not 4 weeks. It is 12 weeks or whatsoever the time. Why? Students going abroad can have the vaccination after 4 weeks, but students coming to Indian universities have to wait for 12 weeks. Why this double standard? Why not the government should come out with a similar thing that all students who are taking admission should be provided the vaccine after 4 weeks? Then reopening of the colleges and universities have no problem, because you have at least those students are protected, but with one dose of vaccination, that protection is not there. What you say about it, Professor Pai?
That is purely the failure on the part of the current government to make such policies. There is no, initially when the vaccines were introduced, the time slot was different between the first vaccine and the second vaccine. Just because government was not able to provide the requisite doses to the concerned, they kept on, changing the dates. We have seen enough, we have witnessed enough memes on what is going to happen when the gap between the first dose and the second dose, when you take at the age of 21, and when really...
So do you agree that the government should have a uniform policy for the vaccination for the...
100%.
Students, at least for the students who are going abroad and who are here. There should not be a priority for those students who are going abroad. After all, Indian students or those who cannot afford to go abroad should not be deprived of the vaccination. What do you say about this, correct?
Exactly. We should not differentiate. It should be uniform across, be it Indian student or students going abroad.
Okay, thank you very much. Now my question goes to Dr. Catherine. Dr. Catherine, you mentioned about the differences in education policies. Why not, when this is for pandemic time, when the Disaster Management Act is applicable, why not the education, everything should be under the one government, that is the central government. They should issue the circular that this going to open or not to be open. Why this division, that even in a city, in a one city, one district, some institutions are opening, some are not opening. They are of autonomous body, they are of a private institution, they are of government. What do you say about it?
So this is last year, there was a central policy on reopening of colleges, and the whole pandemic was managed by the central government, and we saw that there were a lot of challenges. But sometimes we see that it is located in a particular place. Now some states have absolutely no pandemic cases.
And Dr. Catherine, you are right, but I am talking of a district, same district. Some institutions are closed and some are opening. Why?
It shows that the policy's
decision has to be taken at one site. One has to take the local conditions. Thank you very much, Dr. Catherine. Dr. Nagendra, you want to make some point which I cut it. Now you can make, you have 1 minute time. Yes, you can make your point.
When we go through the economic normalcy index of June 24th of 2021, sir, you can see that USA it is having 73 normalcy index. US government. And then, you know, China is also having 73 out of 100. And India is still having, you know, 47, even it is not, you know, having the world, what that we can say, averages, that is, you know, 62. World average is 62. So a lot of serious, you know, problem we have because of the huge population and supply chain problems. So we have to very careful, you know, whenever we are opening it, systematically we open it.
Okay. Now my question to you is, you are mentioning about the foreign universities offering the online classes.
Yes,
definitely. Yes. Now, if it is going to happen, which the, according to the National Education Policy 2020, the government has allowed the online classes. If it is going to happen, what is the future? As you also mentioned, that the student would like to have a Harvard degree or a Oxford degree in comparison to any local university degree. And he or she has to not go there to extra expenditure, same payment, and get that degree. Why the Indian student will like to go for the universities or the colleges, local colleges, why not to take the best degree in the world? What you say? 1 minute only. So, 30 seconds. Yes, please.
In future, the educational universities or institutions, autonomous bodies will be the research, you know, oriented institutions, wherein, you know, periodically you can go and take the consultancy, and you need not be every day, you need not be there. You need not be there. You are doing your own.
So what is going to happen according to Dr. Pais, the lush green campus, what is going to happen? All these buildings will not be required. That is what I'm saying. And unless the research work will not improve in India, why the students would like to go for these universities, those who want to know? Earlier, they were having reservation because they have to pay the very much, lots of amount to go traveling, staying and this thing. Yes. But now in online, everyone can stay at home and can take a degree without any bias with any Indian universities. But either they have to raise their standard in such a way that the employability will increase. Otherwise, the future is very clear that the online educators will come and then they will educate and mint the money, and the students will also be dependent.
You have to choose it.
Okay. Thank you very much. So today, viewers, you have seen how the our experts have given the opinion. They say that reopening is required. But the only problem is the prevention, how to create the prevention. And the best remedy is the vaccination. But the Indian policy for the Indian universities are that the vaccination has to be given after 3 months for the first dose, at least have the Covishield I am talking, while the other countries have put it very clear. So for the USA, I can say that the government has allowed those who have the admission card for the USA that after 4 weeks, they can take the Covishield so they can fly to USA. So the government should change this policy even for the Indian university or Indian colleges, and the colleges have lots of challenges. The fees is a problem. Here, my suggestion is that the government should try to compensate the colleges, those who are private or autonomous, those who are not depending on the government aid, so that they can give a quality education, so the standard of our education system should not go down. Thank you very much. And today's program has been live telecasted by V4 News, Global TV, V4 Stream, News Gaon Se, Samvad Sarokar News, Malnadu TV India, Bharat Post News, as well as it was shown live on Facebook and YouTube. And our endeavor is to bring to you every day new thing. And as you know that in the evening program where we are bringing one achiever who has achieved in his life journey. So today's my chief guest is in the program called Kal Aaj Aur Kal Lal Goel Ke Sang. It's a half an hour program from 4:30 to 5. My chief guest is Dr. Puneet Gupta, MBBS, MD, DNB, DM, Director of Oncology, Metro Cancer Hospital, New Delhi, and the founder, MD, spiritualbiology.com and puneetcodeindus.com from New Delhi. He will be telling his achievements in his own life journey from childhood to the present time. So please do join it for Kal Aaj Aur Kal Lal Goel Ke Sang at 4:30 p.m. Thank you very much, Professor Ramesh. Thank you very much, Professor Dr. Pai. Thank you very much, Dr. Catherine. And thank you very much, Dr. Nagin, for joining us and giving your views. And thank you all the viewers for joining and watching our show.